Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
A very good morning to all of you. So today in this lecture, we'll discuss about parameter estimation. In previous discussions, we emphasized on descriptive statistics. We talked about random variables, their distributions, and we focused on special type of random variables. And also we discussed about the sampling properties, or let's say sampling distributions of the sample mean and sample variance. So the purpose of these were to build a foundation that allows statisticians to draw conclusions about the population parameters from experimental data. For example, the central limit theorem provides information about the distribution of the sample mean. Now, the distribution involves the population mean mu. Thus, any conclusions drawn concerning mu from an observed sample average must depend on the knowledge of this sampling distribution. So, similar things could also apply for, let's say, sample variance and population variance. So we can start by formally outlining the purpose of statistical inference. So the field of statistical inference, as we discussed earlier also, it consists of those methods which are used to make decisions or to draw conclusions about a population. So these methods utilize the information contained in a sample from the population in drawing conclusions. And the trend of today is to distinguish between the classical method of estimating a population parameter, so whereby the inferences are based strictly on information obtained from a random sample selected from the population. And there is another method called Bayesian method, which utilizes prior subjective knowledge about the probability distribution of the unknown parameters in conjunction with the information provided by the sample data. So throughout this course or this lecture, we'll discuss mostly about the classical methods of estimation. So today we'll discuss about the point estimation. What are point estimates? What are point estimator? And then methods of obtaining those estimates. Let's say we'll talk about method of moments and then maximum likelihood method. So let us just start with an example. Let us suppose that an engineer or an analyst is analyzing the tensile strength of a component used in an automobile or let's say any locomotive part. So now, since variability in this particular property, which is the tensile strength, is naturally present between the individual components, and this can arise because of differences in, let's say, raw material batches, manufacturing processes, and measurement procedures. And let's say the engineer is interested in estimating the mean tensile strength of the components. So in practice, what he or she will do, they will use sample data to compute a number that is in some sense a reasonable value, or let's say a reasonable guess of the true mean. Now this number is called a point estimate. And we will see in the course of this discussion if it is possible to establish the precision of such an estimate. Okay, now suppose we want to obtain a point estimate of a population parameter. Okay, we don't know about the population parameter, and it is our desire that we know about it. Okay, that is what one part of statistical inference is all about. And we know that before the data is collected, the observations are considered to be random variables. So let's say we have x1, x2, xn, those are those consists of our random sample. So therefore, any function of the observation, okay, if we desire to formulate any function of such random variables, which is nothing but your statistic, so that is also a random variable. For example, your sample mean or sample variance are statistics, and they're also random variables because they're functions of random variables. Okay. So we would try to have a statistic which we build out of those, let's say, sample random variables, and try to estimate about the population parameter. So, and it is always convenient to have a general symbol to represent the parameter of interest. So in this course, we'll use theta, small theta, the Greek symbol theta, to represent the population parameter. So, and the objective of point estimation, so today we are going to discuss only about point estimation, is to select a single number, or is to arrive at a single number based on our sample data, which would be the most plausible value for theta. And the numerical value of such a sample statistic, which we'll use to estimate about the population parameter, is your point estimate. So in general, if x is a random variable with probability distribution, let's say fx, characterized by unknown parameter theta, and if you draw a sample x1, x2, xn of n size, the statistic which you would formulate to estimate the population parameter small theta is usually denoted by your capital theta hat. Okay, theta hat, because this is the statistic which you are constructing from your sample, and this is called the point estimator of theta. So this capital theta hat is used to estimate the best possible value of theta, and is therefore called a point estimator of theta. And it's a function of your sample random variables, because you have to estimate your population parameter from the information available in the random sample. Now, after you select the sample and you define your theta hat, the point estimator, so then if you calculate, you will get a numerical value for that particular point estimator. So it takes on a particular numerical value, which you generally denote by small theta hat, and that particular numerical value is called the point estimate of the population parameter theta. So what is a point estimate? It is a single numerical value, commonly denoted as small theta hat, of the statistic capital theta hat. So the capital theta hat is the point estimator, and once you define your point estimator, which is the function of your random sample random variables, you will get typically a single numerical value for that point estimator, and that value is known as the point estimate. And these estimation problems occur frequently in science and engineering. So one often needs to estimate, let's say, the mean of a single population, or the variance, or let's say standard deviation of a single population, and the proportion of items in a population which possess a certain characteristics, or you are interested in a proportion of items that belong to a certain class of interest as per the analyst's need, and then the difference in mean of two populations, or the difference in two population proportions. These sort of differences are used for comparative studies. So many a times we face problems where we need to estimate the parameters of single, or let's say two populations. And we may have different choices for the point estimator of a parameter. Let's say, for example, if we wish to estimate the mean of a population, we might consider the sample mean or the sample median or perhaps the average of the smallest and the largest observations in the sample as our point estimators. Okay, so in order to decide which point estimator of a particular parameter is the best one, we need to examine their statistical properties and develop some criteria for comparing estimators. Okay, and one of the important criteria is the unbiasedness of the estimators. So what are called unbiased estimators? So a point estimator is said to be an unbiased estimator of the population parameter theta if its expected value is equal to the population parameter theta. That means if E, so you have a statistic which is your point estimator, then you study the sampling distribution of that statistic. Okay, and now if you calculate the expected value of that statistic, of that distribution of that statistic, then if it is equal to theta, if it is equal to the population parameter, then that estimator is called an unbiased estimator. And supposedly it is not an unbiased estimator, then the difference between the theta and the expected value of this estimator is called the bias of the estimator. Okay, that's how we define bias of the estimator. Okay, so when we formulate an estimator, we expect that it should be close in some sense to the true value of the unknown parameter. Right, so this is equivalent to saying that the mean of the probability distribution of this point estimator should be equal to theta. Right, so that's how we define the biasedness, or let's say unbiasedness, of the estimator. So you take the difference between the expectation value of your point estimator and then you have the value of your theta. If the expectation value is equal to theta, then the difference is zero, and then you call your point estimator to be an unbiased estimator. Now supposedly the difference is not equal to zero, so that difference is called the bias of the estimator. Now let's take an example. Show that sample mean and the sample variance are unbiased estimators of mu and sigma square respectively, where mu is typically your population mean and sigma square is a variance of your population. This is something which we have already seen before. So you calculate the expectation value of the sample mean, it comes out to be mu. And if you similarly, in the previous lecture, we also demonstrated to compute the expected value of the sample variance. And by the virtue of the definition, which is your x minus x bar whole square, and it summation over the square of the deviations scaled by n minus 1. That's how we define our sample variance. If you take the expected value of sample variance, it comes out to be equal to the population variance. So here you see the expected value of these two statistic, namely the sample mean and the sample variance, are equal to the population mean and population variance respectively. And if you calculate the bias, it comes out to be zero. So these two are unbiased estimators of population. Sample mean and sample variance are unbiased estimators of population mean and population variance respectively. But you should be careful that although sample variance is an unbiased estimator for population variance, the sample standard deviation is a biased estimator for population standard deviation, and this is something which you can check yourself. But for large samples, this bias is very small, and typically when we deal with large samples, we ignore this bias. So after we are clear about what are unbiased or biased estimators, we should move to discussion on variance of point estimators. So, see, we started to discuss about this biasness because we wanted to choose which should be our, what should be the criteria of a good estimator. Now, we can also show that all of these are, let's say, all of the, I mean, these unbiased estimators are not unique. Okay, so you can have many estimators for a single population parameter which are unbiased. And then how do you select which one of them is best of the lot? Right, so that means you just cannot rely on the property of unbiasedness alone to select your estimator. So you need a method to select among unbiased estimators, and one of that method is to know about the variance of point estimators. So let's say your capital theta 1 hat and capital theta 2 hat be two unbiased estimators for theta, which is unknown, which is the unknown parameter of your population. So what does it indicate? That the expectation value of theta 1, capital theta 1 hat, and expectation value of capital theta 2 hat both are equal to theta. That means the distribution of each estimator is centered at true value of theta. However, it can happen that the variance of these distributions, the sampling distributions of both theta 1 and theta 2, might differ. So the rule of thumb is that the estimator with smaller variance is more likely to produce an estimate close to the true value. Okay, so logical principle of estimation: when selecting among several estimators, let's say several unbiased estimators, is to choose the estimator that has minimum variance. So if you consider all unbiased estimators of theta, the estimator with the smallest variance is called the minimum variance unbiased estimator, or MVUE in short. Okay, now let's just take an example. So if you have many unbiased estimators, so all of them will have the expectation value to be equal to the unknown population parameter, then how do you choose which one would be best for your analysis? Okay, so then you just simply compute the variances, their spread, because you should know how the sampling distribution is, and you select the one which has the minimum variance. And that particular estimator which has the smallest variance is called the minimum variance unbiased estimator. So we'll take a very simple example. So we have a simple random sample, let's say of size 4. So deliberately it's of a smaller size. And then you devise two point estimators for population mean. And given that unknown population has a mean mu and variance sigma square, and you have to estimate the population mean. So you formulate two statistics, which are your capital theta 1 and capital theta 2. And these are the mathematical formulations. Now you have to choose which is the better estimator. So first criteria would be, we would look for the biasedness. Okay. So you calculate the expectation value of capital theta 1 and the expectation value of capital theta 2, and you see that both are equal, both comes out to be mu. Please check it for yourself. So that means both the estimators are unbiased. Now we can compare the variances to check which one has the smallest variance. So you calculate the variance of each of these estimators, and you can see that the variance of theta 1 is smaller compared to the variance of theta 2. Okay, so now if you see this, you can know that, you can conclude that theta 1 is a better estimator than theta 2. Okay, so now I would suggest that you also take sample mean as one of the third estimator, which would be like x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 divided by 4. So that would be your sample mean. Now check, and of course it's expectation value will be mu. So that would also be an unbiased estimator of mu. Then you calculate the variance. You know what is the variance of sample mean, and check which one would be the better estimate compared to theta 1 and theta 2. And the general rule is that if your x1, x2 and xn is a random sample of size n from a normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square, then the sample mean is the minimum variance unbiased estimator for mu. Okay. Now then let's define something called mean squared error of an estimator. Okay, so many a times it becomes necessary to use a biased estimator. So we'll come to that situation. In such cases, the mean squared error of the estimator can be important. So let's define what is this mean squared error. It's nothing but the expected value of the squared difference between, between capital theta hat and theta. Okay, so you can see that this expected value of theta hat minus theta, the square of that will give you the mean squared error, because theta prime minus theta would be like the difference from the true value, and then you just square it and then take their expectation value. That would give you the mean squared error of that estimator. And if you just calculate a bit, if you do the two more steps, then you can see that the mean squared error is equal to the variance of your point estimator plus the square of the bias. So for unbiased estimators, we know that the bias is zero, so it is nothing, mean squared error is nothing but the variance of the point estimator. This is something which you can easily see. So now let's define what is standard error. So when the numerical value or point estimate of a parameter is reported, it is usually desirable to give some idea of the precision of estimation. Like, you just don't give a random numerical value which you get from the from your point estimator, but you have to say that numerical value. You have to say something about the precision, or what is its variability, what is the error associated with that. So the measure of precision usually employed is the standard error of the estimator. So normally we quote the standard deviation of that point estimator to be the standard error associated with that numerical value. Now if the standard error involves unknown parameters, okay, so it might happen, like you get, like, for the mean, sample mean, the standard, the variance is sigma square by n. Now it involves sigma square, which is an unknown population parameter. So if the standard error involves unknown parameters, and by some means you can estimate those unknown parameters, then you better substitute that sigma square with the estimation of the unknown parameters, and then you quote your standard error as sigma, let's say capital theta hat, and then that error is not called as the standard error, but it's called an estimated standard error, because you are estimating some of the components in the formulation by your sample. Okay, so whenever you have a numerical estimate, you have a theta hat, then you always quote your theta hat with the standard error associated with that theta hat. That is the usual criteria, usual practice. Okay. Now let's do a simple example. So let x1, x2, again xn be a random sample from a distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square, and two estimators of mu are proposed, x1 and the sample mean. Then calculate the mean squared error of both these point estimators. Okay, So we'll just use the standard definition of mean squared error, and then we use their mathematical formulation in place of those point estimators to get that, to compute the mean squared error. For the first case, it comes out to be sigma squared, and the second case, you know it already that the variance of the mean is sigma squared by n. So you can see that for n greater than 1, the second one is always less than the first one. So it is a better estimator than the first one. Okay, now let's define something called relative efficiency of an estimator. So this mean square error is an important criterion for comparing two estimators. So let's say, let your theta 1 and theta 2 be two estimators of the same parameter, let's say theta. And let you also estimate the mean squared error of both these point estimators, and let that be MSE theta 1 and MSE theta 2. Then you define the relative efficiency is defined as the ratio of the mean squared errors of these point estimators. Now, if this relative efficiency is less than 1, so you can conclude that theta 1, for this, let's say for this sort of definition, you can conclude that theta 1 is a more efficient estimator of theta than, you know, theta 2. Now, why we use that? Because sometimes we find that biased estimators are preferable to unbiased estimators. Although the chances are rare, but sometimes you come across such situations. And just because they have a smaller mean square error, that is, we may be able to reduce the variance of the estimator considerably by introducing a relatively small amount of bias. So as long as the reduction in variance is greater than the squared bias, an improvised estimator from a mean square viewpoint will result. For example, consider the figure shown in the slide. It shows the distribution of, let's say, two estimators, theta 1 and theta 2. And you can see that theta 2 is an unbiased estimator because it is centered around the population parameter theta, while theta 1 is a biased estimator because you can see that the expectation value of theta 1 is not equal to theta. Right, but you can see that as from the probability distribution of the estimators, theta 1 has a smaller variance compared to the unbiased estimator theta 2. So an estimate based on theta 1 would more likely to be close to the true value of theta than which would occur from an estimate based on theta 2. So we'll see that normally when we do this regression analysis, we sometimes use this bias estimators, okay, because they approach the unknown population value more faster than compared to the unbiased ones. Okay, so any estimator where the mean squared error is less than or equal to the mean square errors of any other estimator for all values of the parameter is called an optimal estimator. And they are rare, but that's how we define them. So when there are two estimators, you can always compare the efficiency between the two by calculating the relative efficiency of the estimator. It is generally done by the taking the ratio of the mean squared error of both the point estimators, and if it is less than 1, then you can easily say that the point estimator which is in the numerator is a more efficient estimator of theta than which is in the denominator. Okay. Now another property of the estimator is your consistency. Okay, so we'll define something called consistent estimator. And the way we define a consistent estimator is that an estimator of a population parameter theta, let's say your capital theta hat, is called a consistent estimator if it converges or if it approaches the true value of theta when you increase the sample size. So when your sample size becomes very large or it tends to infinity, then the value of the point estimator, if it approaches theta or if it becomes equal to theta, then that estimator is called a consistent estimator. And in the language of statistics, we can define that the probability of the absolute value of the difference between the point estimate and theta is greater than epsilon will be equal to zero when n tends to infinity. Okay, now let's say for an example, let theta 1, theta 2, this capital, all these point estimators, let you take a sequence of this point estimators of theta. Now if the mean square error of these point estimators, okay, if it goes to zero as your n approaches large values, n goes to infinity, then theta n is a consistent estimator of theta. This you can easily see from the utilization of Markov's inequality. So you just can directly utilize your Markov's inequality, which says that the probability of theta minus theta square greater than e square is less than the expectation value of theta minus theta square by e square. And you know that the numerator, which is the expectation value of theta minus theta square, is nothing but your mean square error. And from the proposition, this goes to zero as n goes to infinity, so that this probability also goes to zero, and that is what the definition of a consistent estimator is. Then let's do a simple example. So suppose x1, x2, xn be a random sample with mean theta and variance sigma square. We can show that sample mean is a consistent estimator of theta. So we can use directly a Chebyshev's inequality, which has the formulation that the probability of x bar minus theta greater than sigma is less than variance of x bar by e square, and variance of x bar is nothing but sigma square by n. This is something which we know and which goes to zero as n approaches infinity, and this is nothing but the condition of being a consistent estimator. So sample mean is always a consistent estimator. Now let's do another example. So let x1, x2, xn be a random sample from a uniform distribution where theta is unknown. So if an estimator of theta is defined as, like, it's a maximum of all the random values, all the random variables which are selected in your random sample. So find the bias of that estimator, find the mean square of that estimator, and if that estimator is a consistent estimator of theta. So what we do, we first find it's a continuous distribution, and we know the probability distribution function of a uniform random variable. So that is 1 by b minus a. A is 0 here, b is theta, so it is 1 by theta. Similarly, we can know the cumulative distribution function, which is x minus a by b minus a. X minus a is 0 and b is theta, so it is x by theta. So, and the PDF of the maximum is following the order statistics comes out to be n times x to the power n minus 1 by theta to the power n. And once we know the PDF of the estimator, that means we know the distribution function of the sample statistic, which is the maximum of all the values selected in the sample. And then we can, once we know the distribution, once we know the PDF, we can easily calculate the expectation value, we can easily calculate the variance. and we also, so therefore we calculate the expectation value of theta n, which comes out to be n by n plus 1 times theta. Similarly, we can calculate the second moment, which comes out to be n by n plus 2 times theta square. And once we know the first and second moment, we can easily calculate the variance. And this is the expression of the variance. So the bias is given by the expectation value of the estimator minus theta, which is minus theta by n plus 1. Similarly, once you know the variance, you know the bias, then you can calculate the mean squared error, which comes out to be 2 by n plus 1 times n plus 2. And this whole times theta square is the mean squared error. That's what comes from the calculation. Please do this calculation yourself to verify whether the results mentioned here are correct or not. And then from the expression of mean squared error, you can easily see that it will approach 0 for as n goes to larger values. So therefore, it is a consistent estimator. So the idea is that once you have an estimator, you can easily estimate its properties, like whether it is a biased or an unbiased estimator, what is its variance, what is its mean squared error. And if you have two of them, you can compare which is a more efficient estimator, and you can also check whether it is a consistent estimator or not. Now let's come to something called method of moments. So whatever definitions we have used now about the point estimators, let's say about their unbiasedness, about their efficiency, about their consistency, and all these properties of estimators, they do not provide any guidance about how good estimators can be obtained. How do you obtain good estimators? How do we know that, let's say, the sample mean would be a good estimator for the population mean? So supposedly I give you a random variable, then how do you, let's say I give you a Poissonian random variable which has a single parameter lambda, then, and if I give you a sample from that very distribution, then how do you formulate your point estimator? How do you arrive at the statistic which can act as your point estimator to estimate lambda? So there comes these two methods for obtaining point estimators. Okay, so one of them is method of moments and the other is maximum likelihood method. So maximum likelihood method is usually the widely used one because it has been observed that it is more efficient compared to these methods. But nevertheless, you can use both of them, and both of them can produce unbiased point estimators. Normally you use maximum likelihood estimators because they have better efficiency properties, but sometimes this moment estimators are also used because sometimes they're easy to compute. So let's talk about method of moments first, and then it will be followed by our discussion of method of maximum likelihood. So the general idea behind the method of moments is to obtain the moments, raw moments from the sample, and compare it to the population moments. Okay, and we know that what are moments? Moments are nothing but the expected value of your various powers of x. So that means your expected value of x, suppose x is a random variable defining a certain population, then expected value of x is your first moment, expected value of x square is your second moment, and so on. And if you calculate, you know that these population moments will be functions of those unknown parameters. And our objective here is to estimate those unknown parameters. Okay, so what do you do is that you obtain the moments from the population, and then you obtain the moments, similar moments from your sample, and then you try to equate these moments. Because you tend to believe that your sample is a good representative of your population, and then solve these equations to yield the values or yield the estimates for your, let's say, population. So supposedly x1, x2, xn be a random sample from the probability distribution fx. So the kth population moment, as I discussed, as I mentioned just now, is expectation value of different powers of x. So the corresponding kth sample moment would be, let's say you obtain from your xi to the power k and just you scale by n. So that would be your kth sample moment. And this moment estimators are obtained by equating the kth population moment to the kth sample moment. Because you tend to believe that this sample, whatever you have obtained, is a true representation of your population. And we know that once you define, once for any probability distribution function, if you completely know all its moments, then you can exactly define your probability distribution function. So assuming that your sample is a true representative of your population, you tend to believe that the sample moments also would be like, so your sample statistic or your sample would be, the distribution of your sample would be like your population, and hence you can equate the sample moments with the population moments. So once you do that, the resulting equations will have those unknown parameters, and you can have number of equations equal to the number of parameters, and you can solve them to obtain the estimates for your population parameters. So let's do a simple example. Suppose we have a normal distribution which we widely find in day-to-day life, and if you draw a sample of size n from that normal population, and you want to estimate mu and sigma square, because your normal population is described by two parameters, mu and sigma square. So then, and you know that the first moment of a normal population is mu, and your second moment is mu square plus sigma square. This is something which we had discussed when we discussed about the normal random variable, and we saw that the first moment and second moment and all other moments can be obtained from the moment generating function. And we saw that the first moment is mu and the second moment is mu square plus sigma square. Now you do the same for your, let's say, sample. Okay, so sample mean would be the first moment. So you equate it to the population first moment. So that will give you that mu is equal to x bar. That is, the estimator for mu of a normal population is the sample mean. Then the second thing is that you equate the second moment of the population, which is mu square plus sigma square, to the second moment for the sample, which is 1 by n times sum over xi square. Okay, because these are all raw moments. By doing so, you can get that sigma square is nothing but xi minus x bar whole square sum over for all n values divided by n. But here you can easily see that the estimator which you have obtained for sigma square is not an unbiased one, because it is scaled by n, not n minus 1. Okay, but your sample mean is surely an unbiased estimator. Okay, so this is one of the methods which you can use to obtain point estimators for different unknown population parameters. And next method which we'll discuss is method of maximum likelihood. Now what does this say about? Now suppose that the random variables x1, x2, xn whose joint distribution is assumed given except for that unknown parameter theta are to be observed. So the problem of interest here to use the observed value of the samples to estimate theta. That's what we are doing. From the sample we are estimating the population parameter. Okay, so let us suppose that x is a random variable with some probability distribution fx theta, where theta is a single unknown. Supposedly you can have other probability distributions like normal or gamma distributions where you can have more than one parameter. Okay, so suppose let's just imagine it to be a simple case, and we have a PDF where you have a single unknown parameter theta. Now if you select x1, x2, your random sample of size n, then the likelihood function of this sample is defined to be the joint probability distribution function of the random variables x1, x2, xn. And you can write them as a product of this probability. So if it is discrete, you can write it as a product of the probability max mass function. And if it is continuous, you can write it as a product of probability distribution functions, because they are also, because we know that these random variables x1, x2 and xn are independent random variables. Okay. And so because theta is assumed to be unknown, okay, so now this likelihood function represents the likelihood that the values of the random variables, which are your, let's say, small x1, small x2, will be observed when theta is the true value of the parameter. So it would seem that a reasonable estimate of theta would be that value yielding the largest likelihood of the observed values, right? So in other words, the maximum likelihood estimate, which is your, let's say, theta hat, is defined to be that value of theta which maximizes the likelihood function, where your this random sample are the observed value. So therefore, this L x1 x2 theta is often referred to as the likelihood function of theta. So this joint probability distribution function, which is your L, is also known as the maximum likelihood function, and the maximum likelihood estimator theta of theta would be that value of theta that maximizes this likelihood function. Now let's see with an example how we estimate the point estimator using this method. Now let's start with a typical simple Bernoulli random variable which has a single parameter p, and it's a discrete random variable, and we know that what is the probability mass function. It is p to the power x times 1 minus p to the power 1 minus x. So the likelihood function of the random sample, suppose you draw a sample of size n from this random distribution, then the likelihood, since all these random variables are independent, so you can write the joint probability function for this sample as the product of individual probability mass function, which is your likelihood function. Okay, so LP is your likelihood function, P is unknown. Okay, you can write it as P to the power x1 times 1 minus P to the power 1 minus x1, then P to the, you can write it them as a product. Okay, so now the way we defined our maximum likelihood function is that you have to estimate P such that it maximizes the likelihood function. Since and we know that while maximizing the likelihood function, it is often useful to use the fact that your likelihood function and the log likelihood function, that is the logarithm of this likelihood function, have their maximum at the same value of x. So same value of theta. So even if you maximize the likelihood function or you maximize the log of this likelihood function, it is essentially the same thing. So many a times when there are a lot of exponents and exponential functions are involved, it is advisable that you use log functions so that your calculations, your computations become simpler. So what you can do, once you define your likelihood function, you can also define your log likelihood function. Okay. So ln lp is, you can write the logarithmic of this likelihood function. So then you can maximize LP. So how do we do that in calculus? You differentiate with respect to P with that parameter and then equate it to zero to obtain the, let's see, something is not coming, right? To obtain that, it's not showing in the slide. To obtain that, P is actually the mean of the sample. And this is actually correct. Then similarly, we can check the maximum likelihood estimator for the exponential parameter lambda, which is a continuous probability distribution. So the idea is first to write the PDF of an exponential random variable, then estimate its likelihood function depending upon your sample size. So the likelihood function would be the product of individual PDFs corresponding to each random variable in the sample. So then you take the compute the log likelihood function. So which is here, when you calculate the log, it becomes easier. You can see that it is n log of lambda minus lambda times sum over x size. Then you maximize this function with respect to for lambda. So you differentiate with respect to lambda and then equate it to zero to obtain the point estimator of lambda, which is nothing but n by sum over x size, which is the inverse of the mean, and we know that the mean of the exponential function is 1 by lambda. So this is also agreeing with what we have observed here. So with this method, you can also try to compute the estimators of a Poisson parameter. You can calculate estimators for mu and sigma square of a normal random variable. So whatever random variable, special random variables you have studied, you can use this method to compute the estimators of all those parameters used in random variable, on those special random variables. Now also let's try to see the maximum likelihood function of a uniform random variable parameter. This is interesting because the method really doesn't work here, because you know that the probability distribution function is 1 by theta. Now if you draw a sample of size n, the likelihood function becomes 1 by theta to the power n, provided your uniform random variable is defined between 0 and theta. So now it is a continuously decreasing function of theta, this likelihood function, okay, 1 by theta n. So you can't find a slope where it's 0, right? So you can't really maximize using the usual techniques of calculus. So the rule of thumb here is that you will maximize this function where you choose the smallest possible value for theta, right? Smallest possible value for theta. So that means if you choose the maximum of x, whatever random sample use, then you will likely the best smallest possible value for theta would be the maximum of x1, x2, xn, and hence that would maximize the likelihood function. Okay. So therefore, for a uniform random variable, the best estimator of theta is the maximum value of x1, x2 and xn. And if you use method of moments, you won't get for this uniform random variable. Please try to check with method of moments also. So there the estimator for theta would be something different. Try to see and verify yourself. So these are the usual two methods which we use to estimate population parameter in theory of parameter estimation. One is the method of moment and second is the maximum likelihood method. It's also known as the log likelihood method, because normally we calculate the log likelihood function and try to maximize it with respect to the parameters of interest. We discussed about, in today's lecture, we discussed about the point estimation. So here we calculate one single value for the population parameters which are unknown to us. We discuss some of the properties of point estimators which are useful to select or useful to choose our point estimators. These are usually based on unbiasedness, and efficiency and the consistency of the point estimators, and we defined them on basis of their variance of their mean squared values, and how do we say that they're consistent or they're efficient by comparing the variances or let's say their mean squared error values. So these are the characteristics of the point estimators and help us to choose between various unbiased point estimators, because we want our point estimator to be efficient so that it can really estimate our population parameter efficiently. Then we discussed about how to obtain those point estimators, and in the process we discussed about two methods, namely the method of moments and the likelihood function method. In the method of moments, the general idea is to compare the various moments of same order across the population and the sample, while in likelihood function, we define likelihood function, which is nothing but the joint probability function of the independent random variables which we have selected for our sample, and then define that as a likelihood function and then maximize that function with respect to that parameter and obtain the point estimator. So this is all about point estimation, what we'll be discussing in this course. So in the next lecture we'll talk about interval estimation. Okay, that is again one part of the inferential statistics and is most important and widely used for parameter estimation. Thank you very much.